Hello, everyone, and welcome to our game update 6.3 live stream. You know, I probably should have had the name here. Probably would have been a little more exciting than just the numbers. Hindsight is 2020, and we are live, so it doesn't matter anymore. I'm joined by other people, so let's do some quick introductions for those of you that don't know me. Eric Musco, community manager. Jackie.
Jackie, hi, newest addition to the community team. I'm Jackie. Nice meeting you all of you.
Schmidt.
Chris Schmidt, game design director.
Charles Boyd, who needs no introduction.
People have seen me on streams forever, along by your side. I'm just glad we have some new folks to, share some awesome stuff instead of just the same old, same old.
That's right.
Yeah, I'm the creative director. I do, I don't actually do anything.
The best reason for Charles to be on streams is when we're getting set up. Charles is like, "Be right back. I gotta grab another helmet," which only is possible in a world that Charles is on stream. Only possible. Let's go through quickly how today's stream is going to work, so you know exactly what we're going to talk about. We just did intro. We'll talk about giveaways in a second. We always want to make sure you get free stuff on these streams. We'll just take a quick look back at the last two game updates. If you're not familiar with some of the things we've done recently, just want to make sure you know what those are. And then we're going to get into some of the meat of 6.3. So we're going to talk about the story of what's coming in 6.3. We have two special guests today, Moira Quirk, who we'll talk a little bit about more about who she is and who she voices in a bit. There's a new Flashpoint coming in game update 6.3. Some of you may have guessed where we're going, but hold on. You're probably right, but we'll tell you factually that later. Second special guest, Gideon Emery, to kind of get towards closing things out. And then we're going to go into Galactic Seasons, which is a brand new system, can I call it a system, coming in 6.3. I also realized this isn't exactly in the order it's going to go, but it's pretty close. So,
You gotta keep people guessing, man. You wanna keep exciting.
On toes.
Yes. Yeah. It's like a smorgasbord. I could just grab, pick and choose whatever we want to talk about at any given time. Throughout also, Jackie intrepidly is going to be grabbing questions and comments and stuff from Twitch chat. So please be sure to get questions in as they're coming up. Jackie, you want to talk to people about how they win stuff?
Yeah, so all you have to do really is just be active in chat. Don't spam. Spam is a good food ingredient. It's not great in chat. But all you have to do is be active. And so some of the things that we're going to be giving away today, there's going to be five winners that are picked for the lightsaber. So we have the Fractured Bogan or Ashla lightsaber. You can choose which one you want. So there's going to be five winners there. And there's also going to be five winners for the Vectron Minok jetpack. Cool thing about this bad boy is that players can toggle to adjust the flames to go vertically or horizontally. And also, the flame color is dependent upon what color crystal you have equipped. So that's pretty cool. Again, we're going to give a little bit of a heads up as to when the giveaway is going to be active. So just pay attention. Like I
Everybody's
just told
spamming
you
right
stuff.
now. You're technically not entered, but I appreciate the enthusiasm.
Yeah. Hello, everyone. It's nice seeing everybody.
Quick look back. We've done stuff recently, so let's make sure just real quickly, what are the things we've done in the most recent updates? Charles, you want to tell them about 6.2?
Yeah, man, 6.2, we had some major stuff go down. You fought another version of the Emperor and in fact met his original form for the first time, which was super cool.
Spoilers, by
Love
the way.
seeing, yeah, spoilers, sorry. We're
We should have
past it
put that
now.
up front. We're going to tell
Good
you story
call.
stuff that's a few months ago, so sorry.
Plug your ears for approximately 5 minutes. Yeah, so that was really cool. I was really excited to bring that to life. The whole team really came together to get like every character ever in the game and in other games into this game for one big last hurrah. Then we also kicked off a totally new storyline, still involving some of our beloved characters like Shay Vizsla and Taurian. But yeah, the big Mandalorian story flashpoint that we did also introduced a new character, Hedda Kole. So yeah, you expect to see more from them a little down the road. Yeah, Schmidt, do you want to talk about login rewards and
Yeah, we also introduced a new system in 6.2, which rewarded you just for logging into the game and gave some bonuses to subscribers. We also launched a new emote window that organizes them all a bit better and allows you to preview them in a bit clearer way. And yeah, 6.2 was a big update for us. Lots of stuff in there.
this is one of those I'd say like go read the patch notes because they were monumental. I think that's what the end more was is
Many pages.
read patch notes. Yeah. 6.2.1, Schmidt, more stuff.
In 6.2.1, so the first thing we did is uprising update. So what we did is rebalanced all of the uprisings and brought them all up to level 75. So what that means is all of the gear you're earning at end game is applicable in this content also. And we're super happy to do that. We added some amplifier quality of life and UI changes. We put in some rarity locking. We added kind of the changed up how you interact with amplifiers and re-roll them in the UI. And then we wrapped up season 13 in ranked PvP. And we will talk about when the next season starts in a minute. And then finally, we put some more conquest changes in. Conquest is one of those systems that we'll touch here and there as we think we need to tune it. But these were changes that that we thought were making it a healthier system going forward.
Bam. So now I put the name. Go ahead, Jackie.
We like lost stream for just a second. I think we're back now though.
Did we? Well, good. This will be even more dramatic when now it bang back on this slide. And now you know Game Update 6.3's name. It's called The Dark Descent.
We're good.
So I'm going to pick up on the story following the events of 6.2, as Charles talked about, and we're going to begin Galactic Seasons. So we'll tell you a little bit about what that stuff means. Charles, Schmidt, you want to talk through this?
Yeah. So like I said, new flashpoint. Secrets of the Enclave. Hey, that's a cool word. I wonder what enclave we could be referring to. Maybe we'll get to that in a second.
What is an enclave even?
Webster's defines enclave. And so it's going to be cool. It's going to be a lot of fun. New storyline to go with it. So, you know, as we've been doing for a while now, it'll be a new flashpoint. You can play multiplayer with your friends, and it will also have a solo full story version that continues the storyline. Partly from 6.2, partly from some other stuff that was kicked off a little even further back than that. It's going to be a lot of fun. Hope you all enjoy it.
We've got Galactic Seasons, which is mystery, but we will do a deep dive in a bit, so I'll save it for that. And also, you didn't have to wait long, but Ranked PvP, you had to wait two slides. Season 14 will begin in Update 6.3.
Do you want to talk about when we'll talk about rewards and stuff for 14, Schmidt?
Yeah, actually, we had been trying to communicate and show the rewards at the beginning of the season, which we did in season 13. This time we're going to continue that, and we're actually going to put the titles out there too, right at the beginning of the season. So you should have a clear roadmap of everything that you're working towards in the season right at the beginning of the season.
Cool. Charles Boyd, Secrets of the Enclave.
Hey, it's that enclave. It's the one you all thought it was. Hooray. Now we're really, really excited. It was it was a location we had kind of hoped we would even be able to do a while back, but we decided to save it for a big Flashpoint storyline like this. So here we are returning to the ruins of the Jedi Enclave from Knights of the Old Republic 1 and 2 in pursuit of everyone's favorite masked Sith Lord. Well, maybe second favorite behind your own masked Sith Lords, Darth Malgus, who's on the loose. As is standard, like I said, we'll have multiple difficulty modes and the solo story version where you kind of make your crit path choices and decide the things for your particular character and see all the scenes. And of course, as usual, some new achievements, some cool stuff, and some cool rewards to find as well.
I realized two things. We're being very bad at suspense in this stream because we're like, when season 14? Two slides later. Which enclave is that? Three slides later. You better pace it.
Yeah, let's just get into it. Life's short. You don't want to leave people hanging.
Yep.
We'll take a few looks at that area, at the Dantooine enclave. And in this case, of course, the outskirts where you land and make your approach. Enemy forces have actually taken control of the enclave. So you're going to be kind of approaching surreptitiously from the exterior. Who the enemy forces are, of course, will swap based on your personal faction. So Imperial or Republic, change things up a little bit. There's the Enclave there in the distance as you're making your approach, or at least what's left of it. Of course, the Enclave was bombed into oblivion a few hundred years before our game began, but-
Also spoilers.
Okay, spoilers for some more than 10-year-old games. but players might remember, you know, some of these crystal caves, remember the general vicinity of the enclave. And then you will eventually break in and explore the interior ruins of the enclave itself. And it looks awesome. I am so, so thrilled with what the art team has put together and what the design team's put together for the flow and for some of the stuff you're getting to do in here. You know, really cool exploration. It's always fun to see, you know, a place we know, but in a new way and in a new kind of take on it. So yeah, like that. That's gorgeous. Really excited for y'all to get in there and run around.
That one's my favorite. It's so pretty.
Yeah, we got the we actually had the chance to play through it as well this week, and it's exciting. We'll talk about when you get to play it later, though.
Yeah. Oh yeah, and then of course it's not a storyline in a Bioware game without some cool characters to run around with. So you will be going on this mission with two allies. In this case, for Imperial players, one of my favorite characters, Darth Krovos. Head of the Imperial military, seat on the Dark Council. She's super cool, super tough. So she'll be joining you on the mission, as well as another favorite of mine, Darth Rivix, that charming, sly man, played by Gideon Emery.
We should talk to him.
Maybe we'll talk about a little bit more about Rivix here in a little bit when we speak with Gideon later on. On the Republic side, new fan favorite. Arn, the Jedi, he'll be joining you on the mission. Need some water. Character we've been teasing for a little while now. You've seen her, but not actually had the chance to meet her. This will be your chance. Erin Lanier, who is a Jedi from the Deceived novel originally. She's got a past with Malgus. She's someone who's dealt with him before and lived to tell about it, which is pretty rare. So she's going to be helping out Republic players as they explore the Dantooine Enclave. And she is played by Moira Quirk, who will be talking about now.
Yeah, so we, following the Cantina stream, one of the things that we certainly heard resoundingly from everyone following our Cantina stream is how much all of you loved getting to hear from the voice actors themselves who play the characters. And so we got the chance to sit down and talk with Moira about her time as Erin Lanier. And she also plays Alara Dorn, if you don't know, as well. So just like last time, as a note, this is pre-recorded. So we're gonna make sure that Moira's Twitter account stuff is tagged in our social. So if you wanna go tell her how awesome she is, and she is awesome, please go do so on social. But she will not be able to respond in chat because she's not here. So just as a note, it is pre-recorded. Although I am wearing the same shirt, I somehow managed laundry appropriately to pull that off, but she's not here. So Dan, if you want to take us away and we can go listen to our interview with Moira and then we'll be back. Hello everyone and welcome. And we are joined today by a very special guest, Moira Quirk, thank you for joining us.
Hello, happy to be here.
I know there's going to be a lot of people that are going to be very excited to hear, what your experience has been with the Old Republic. As people will find out, Moira's been around with our project for quite some time, so it should be fun. So before we jump too far into it, why don't you tell people a little bit about yourself and where they may know you from?
Oh, all right then. Moira Quirk, hello. I've been a voice actress for many, many years. I think you might know me from Star Wars The Old Republic as Alara Dorn. Destiny's sort of a recent game. People know me from Haunting Ground. There's a bunch. If you're playing, you'll hear me. Some cartoons here and there, you'll hear me. Audiobooks, lots of those. And older viewers, millennials may remember me as Mo the referee on Nickelodeon Guts, where I pranced around with an aggro cat, Craig. Yeah.
Oh my goodness. Yes. I will tell you, you seemed familiar to me and I could not place it before we were doing this interview. And boy, the explosion of fireworks in my brain.
Dendrites!
This shouldn't happen live. I'm so excited now. I have so many questions that I want to ask you about that, but I don't think I should. So
yes, well, we'll keep it sort of right. Old Republic-y. That's right.
Cool. Charles, you want to dive into, I guess, some of the character stuff for Moira?
Of course. Ah. So, yeah, of course. We'll talk a little about Alara in a minute, because what I want to jump in with first, of course, is Erin Lanier, who's this cool Jedi character that players have seen a little bit in the game so far, but they're about to really meet up with her and spend some real time with her on a cool mission here coming up very soon. And of course, you know, she goes all the way back to some novel, to a novel that was released many years ago now.
Oh,
so
okay.
She's been a character that's been around for a while. So, but yeah, for players who aren't familiar, who haven't met her yet, tell us a little bit about her and how you approach playing.
Aaron Lanier, okay. Welcome to a world of kickassery, I will say. yeah, she's kind of plays by her own rules. I think she knows the rules and now she's playing by her own rules, which is something I like. I think you should know the rules before you break the rules. And she certainly does. And yeah, I think she's kind of more fly by the seat of your pants, yet thoughtful, good old gal. I'm kind of excited to see what happens with her. Yeah, she's very different from my previous character, so that's kind of fun. Yeah.
Yeah.
Does that answer that?
Without, oh, I think so.
Without giving away too much.
Yeah. We don't want to spoil anything too cool, but yeah, there's lots of good stuff coming up.
Yes. Exciting path of hijinks and adventure. Yeah.
Yeah, and I think actually you've almost kind of got ahead of me here. I wanted to ask, you know, you play Aaron, of course, who is a Jedi who does play by your own rules. Is that, do you think if you yourself were a Jedi, is that how you would be? Or would you be the you know, follow the rules, fight the good fight, you know, wear the proper robes, or, you know, be like Aaron, have your own fashion sense, go out and fight your own battles, pick your own things?
Well, I certainly wouldn't have my own fashion sense. That would be way beyond my ballywick. But I think I am a bit of a rule follower, and I think that you break the rules for very important reasons. That's it should have a good payoff. And also just because I don't think I'm terribly adventurous. Like when I watch thrillers and whatnot, and people are jumping off buildings and then getting up and having a fight and being tortured and then running for 3 miles, I always just go, but I moan so much when I stub my toe. I'm a very much a realist. I'm just like, oh God, that would hurt, I think to myself.
That has
That's me. Oh, hurty, painful. Think is generally my motto. Think about that.
That has been my experience more and more with action movies. It's like when I see someone just like fall down a couple of stairs, I'm like, oof, no, I'm out.
Or people just go, I'm going to climb Mount Everest. And I'm like, why? Someone A, already has, and B, that's what photographs are for. So that's where I live.
Is there anything with the rule following and slight breaking that comes with Aaron? Is there anything that you brought, like inspiration you brought to the character as kind of having that approach from an individual like that?
Gosh, I don't know if deep, to be deep. I don't know if, I think.
I'm here for the existential questions only.
Yeah, I think more simply as I get to know her too, is just sort of an idea of revenge.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, I think she's in a place of just anger and needing an outlet right now. And especially with her being somebody who feels. Mm-hmm. So I don't even think that's a consideration that I thought of, really.
No, maybe I think
I should have, and I'll go and think about that and chastise myself. Yeah.
No, that's good on, you know.
Everyone can attest to, I don't know what I'm doing. So don't follow don't follow my lead on this.
Yeah.
No, you nailed it, because her whole story is this sort of unresolved kind of conflict she had in the past that never quite got solved.
I sometimes wonder if that's a simpler way to live your life, if you know exactly who your enemy is and what you're up against, and you've just got one. I mean, it's just what we can all dream about, really.
it's funny you mentioned too, because certainly, you know, most of the characters you played for us have been kind of heroic characters, even if they come at it very differently.
Yes.
Do you personally have a preference though? Like, do you love playing villains just as much, or is it?
Of course.
Would you secretly rather be? Should I'm not saying she would, but does Aaron need to make a dark turn? Is that what would that be where you'd want to go?
If she does, then I'll welcome it. I love playing the baddies as well. And there's always that sort of cliche I think it's a cliche where people say, you know, well, the bad guys, they think they're doing it for right. And I don't think that. I think there are people who just do what they want to do. They know it's bad, but they just want power. And I find that interesting. I find a complete lack of empathy and humanity as interesting. I think there are those types of bad characters for sure. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, on that note, a character who was in fact so principled that she left her whole family and her whole faction behind, Laura Dorn.
Yeah.
Who played for a little while now, since the beginning of the game, a character of many players, particularly troopers, I've spent a lot of time with. So, you know, yeah, talk a little bit about, you know, how do you approach Alara differently than Aaron?
Well, because their losses are very different, I suppose. There's so much. I guess I think about it just in a very, very simple way that for Aaron, there's still so much anger and need for vengeance, and that's her path. Whereas for Alara, I think it's much more grief. Bound. She's such a realist that, yes, so she must have gone through such a checklist of, am I going to do this? How's my heart going to feel? And just went ahead with it. Yeah, just, yeah, I get chills thinking about leaving a brother behind. That would be awful. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Is it, I know one of the things that Alara has to do more than almost any character is spout off these really long, like form 27AX9-53.
Yeah, what a way to bury your feelings. Bury your feelings. Yes.
A, is that very hard on you? And B, I apologize for having made you do it all these years.
Long lists, but make me a much better cold reader. No, and you're completely forgiven, and it's hilarious. Because, yes, what a way to have whimsy. Whimsy through paperwork. Yeah.
One of the things that's interesting, I think, Moira, that you bring to the game is that you've had the opportunity to play a character that's been around since the beginning, and then also bring in character that's newer, right? That's kind of newer into the game. Is there something that informed when you came to your second character from the first, right? Like, you're now playing two characters in the same world. Is there anything that comes from that when you're playing more than one character that exists in the same space?
Apart from, hooray, I've got a new character. Whee!
Right.
Well, here's the thing. Yes, you want to make them different because there's always that fear that you're this one voice and you want to make two distinct characters, that it won't be confusing. But also the fact that there's all sorts of characters I've played in, the Old Republic that I can't remember. I think there was somebody slightly Welsh once, and just all things that get thrown at you. So yeah, there is that fear of repetition as well, or like you brought out of your canon someone you might have already used. I don't know, that sort of panic. Yeah. You just always want to be truthful and create a good character. You just always want to be a pro.
Yeah, that's one of the things that I think is you said something that's really interesting that I don't know that a lot of players know, that actually I didn't know until I got to interface more with voice actors and with Charles, is that like a lot of our voice actors have characters all over the game, right?
Yeah.
Like they're all over the place. It's not like you've only voiced just Aaron and Alara, right? Like you've unnamed, you know, tons of them that's
yes,
all over the place.
Unnamed, unremembered.
That's right.
Slightly hazy.
Yeah. Someone's now going to accept. I feel like there's now going to be a challenge of like, I'm going to go find Moira all over SWTOR and post it on.
Yes. I hope there's a prize. Whoops, I just knocked my iPad. There we go. Oh, sorry. Product placement. There we go.
Yeah, it's always fun to play that. What will happen sometimes is we'll say, oh, we'll be thinking about, oh, is there an old character we could use for this upcoming thing, right? Like, you know, because we have so many, right?
Yeah.
And then we'll be like, okay, well, let's look at this one. And then we'll realize that actor is already in the scene that we're thinking about doing because they've played both of these people, because there are so many that it's even for me, it's hard to keep straight exactly.
Yeah, well, that's very reassuring to hear, quite honestly. Yeah, yeah. Thank you. Yes.
Phew. and it's, you know, we still will cheat it sometimes. And thankfully, you know, we've got folks like you who are so talented that we probably could actually have you twice in the same scene and pull it off. But we try not to. Yeah. We try to avoid it.
Certainly done that for other projects. So.
Yeah.
But you know, if you don't have to, don't.
So you've obviously been, you know, as we talked about, right? Like you've been Alara since the beginning, and with Aaron. So you've played a Jedi and a soldier. What's the next character that you should play in SWTOR?
Ooh, well, I'm actually sort of a huge fan of like Cold War espionage. So mm-hmm. so what about something like that? Something yeah. sort of spy-like.
Next Imperial spy.
Yeah. So what about and they could be really, really sort of unassuming compared to my two mm-hmm. other characters, like I don't know, Eunice, who works in the canteen, but is actually a spy. And that's a really Star Warsy name, I think. Yes. So that is a gift to you.
Excellent.
That's perfect.
Yes. I'd like some espionage, please. Yes.
Go ahead, Maske.
I feel like the next character that Moira needs to voice will just have like one line in a cantina somewhere, and someone will see this interview and be like, "That's a spy. That's an Imperial spy right there."
Yeah,
I saw that interview that one time. It's the long
they
game.
Gave it to her. Her dreams have come true.
Now every time you see someone in a cantina who has only one line, but it's our friend Moira, you're gonna have to wonder.
/ Eunice.
Right. Yes. Yep. Really, just we're playing the long game. I mean, but that's if you're going to be an Imperial spy, it's all about the long game, right? Got to be unassuming.
Oh yes. Yeah. Oh yes. I know my spy craft. I will be there. I mean, I was shocked to learn how long I'd been playing Alara, so I am willing to give those years again.
In that shock, and we'll see if and I'll coin Charles on this one too, since you've kind of covered it from both sides, you know, having been a part of this project for 10 years or even more, is there any memories that stick out from like recording sessions or anything that you found in like a character, like, you know, things that were unknown to you as you went into sessions or anything like that that sticks out? And obviously same question to you, Charles, if there's something from the writing side.
I don't know if this is shocking or a big revelation, but I have to say there was something so incredibly enjoyable after doing Alara for quite some time. And then we got to the point where there was romance. And I have to say at that time, I didn't realize that there were relationships in these. And it just got to like basically picking china patterns and thinking how the house was going to be decorated and where they should go on their honeymoon. And it was just so delightful after all of the paperwork and officiousness of Alara. It's just like, oh, there you go. Good old gal. It just was kind of surprising. And I found it delicious.
Okay, good. Yeah. I mean, for me, it was just, you know, when we started on the project, the trooper was the first thing I worked on. So Alara was one of the longest running characters I've created stuff for. But, you know, in the beginning, you know, I was not attending voiceover sessions, right? Like I didn't start doing that until later on. And so for me, it was just so much fun to actually finally meet you in person, you know, and get to meet the lady behind
it. Yeah. They were always fun sessions. I remember I started with Will Beckman. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And who is so great with, because there's always so many efforts and he was such a genius at that. He was sort of like, I'm not trying to patronize you. Don't be offended. I'm going to tell you exactly the effort I need. It's going to be a line reading. Just copy me. And it was great. And A, he's fantastic at them. And B, it was just so efficient. Because sometimes, you know, when you get to all of the oohs, it can get a little tricky. And then you leave like this, oh, I failed. And the drive home's awful. But Will made that great. And he's also good at words as well. not just efforts. And words.
It's an aspect of it that I think definitely is kind of goes under the radar for a lot of people and it's sort of underappreciated, right? Like it's, you don't...
I think
in the moment
so.
Because you're hearing them in the middle of a fight. So as a player, you know, you're just trying to hit all the right buttons and do all the right things. You don't realize
that it's really an orchestra that you guys are creating. Yeah. And sometimes you have to say as a person, I can't do the bassoon. You're going to have to stick with trumpet. That's what I can give you. Yeah.
And it can actually be a meaning, like the difference between ooh and ah, that can actually be important to the game. And yet
completely.
You're in the booth, it's like, please do 3,000 of these. And it's...
Or just do one the right way.
It's hard. It's hard work. Yes. You know, you would think that some really long, rambly line about paperwork would be the hardest one, but sometimes it's the shortest, tiniest thing that can actually be.
Bingo. Yes. Nailed it. Yeah. Those are things I remember. Also, I liked that recording studio. It's kind of funky. Yeah.
That's great.
Yeah, we definitely
I like all of them in LA. Recording studio people. Yeah. I love them all. Apart from one. Apart from one, and you need to work out which one.
You know who you are.
You know what you did. Yes.
We're establishing some serious spy vibes from all of this. Yeah. All of this. Getting a good sense of who you are, Moira. I like it a lot. It's good. Good.
Well, we definitely miss, you know, we've been recording from home all this time, right?
Yes.
With COVID and everything, it's quite an adjustment. But
it has been. Everyone has been so incredibly patient with the learning curve that is being tech on the fly. I mean, there's a reason I'm a voiceover artist and not on the other side of the glass. And I'd always been very proud of that. Like, oh, I don't know that. Don't need to. And then 1 year, I needed to know that. My bluff was called, and everyone's been very patient and good about it. But thank goodness, you know, that I can call up a company, they send me equipment, and we just carry on regardless. Yeah,
it's been weird but fun to adjust and
yeah. I mean, how has it been for the all of you? Do you get just appalling quality stuff and just go, oh God, someone's got
No.
Okay.
We've been very, you know, you would think given, you know, we have a cast of 10 million people surely going from one person's closet to someone else's cabana to someone else's attic, you know, like surely this will not work. But between y'all putting in so much effort to you know, to give it the best it can be. And then, you know, we have a lot of behind the scenes folks who work really hard to make things consistent.
Kudos. Cause I am not without empathy. Cause I have thought about that. Just like, oh my God, what must they be going through? Yes. I'm sure sessions take longer.
Yes and no, it depends. You know, I will say we tend to go on a bit kind of like this and talk and have a good time, probably a little more when we're in person than when we're over the phone. So that tended to buff some of the recording times a little.
Yeah.
But it's still it's an adjustment, but hopefully.
Oh, sure. Yes.
Well, Moira, this has been an incredible experience. I know that everyone will be very happy to have been able to hear from the voice herself that they've heard for a great many years. And we look forward to having Alara and Aaron be, you know, a key part of SWTOR so we can keep you coming back.
It's been lovely. I love them. I love them quite a lot. Yes.
They are well loved by the community.
Yes. Yeah. Very much so.
Can't wait to do more. Yep. Yeah. Well, thank you so much.
Okay.
Yeah, well, thank you very much.
So long, chaps.
Yep, and that'll do it for us here. So thank you once again to Moira for joining us today, and we'll kick you back to the rest of the show. Bye. Hello, everyone. Welcome back. Super fun. Just Moira was such a treat to talk to. We could tell we were all enjoying watching chat and watching all of you enjoy that as well. So she was just super fun. Obviously, I apologize for my fanboyness when I realized that she was Mo from Guts. I told every human on earth that once I knew that. So that was great. But we carry on. There is more. Also, please shower Moira with praise on the socials and everywhere following this, because she's so much fun. Jackie, people want free stuff.
Yes, I'm the giver of all the free stuff. All right, so our giveaway for right now is going to be either the Fractured Bogan or Ash the Lightsaber. So there's going to be 5 winners that are chosen. All you have to do is just type something in chat. Please don't spam, but type something in chat that'll
basically puts you into the, gives you a chance to win one of these lightsabers. So five winners are gonna be chosen. Chat will be frozen at some point while we are choosing these. So just letting you know that is intentional. The stream didn't die, nothing like that.
Dan's so on a just power as trip, that's what it is.
It's like, I have the power. So yeah, we will be choosing five names. You will be choosing either one or the other. You will not be receiving both, but it's one or the other. So just as an FYI on that. I think that's all that I needed to say for all of that stuff. So we're going to be moving on to a couple of questions that we saw in chat. So I have three that we're going to be answering while this is going on. So team, can you take a friend in story and progress your own story, or must we do that solo story first?
So the intent of that mode is that you're doing it by yourself and that yours is the only one that advances. To be honest, it's been so long since we set those up, I'm actually not sure what will happen if you try to bring a friend into that mode. So we're going to follow up on that and get an answer out a bit later and let you know. But honestly, it's probably a better experience unless you're bringing in just to help with the mobs or something. It's really the what it's designed for is for your personal story, just like any other solo experience.
Good. Can I add anything else? Moving on to the next question. All right. Question number two, characters we just saw. Romanceable?
The eternal BioWare question, always fair. So I'll be honest, this particular update, not high on the romance charts, but if we're speaking theoretically about all four characters, let's see. Darth Krovos, we've never really gotten into what her situation is. There was always some kind of, you know, maybe her and Admiral Rankin might've had a thing. Or maybe they're just really good friends, you don't know. So I'm gonna say maybe, but she's definitely someone who might kill you in your sleep, so be careful with that. Let's see, Darth Rivix, definitely someone who would murder you in your sleep, but you'd have a great time together. we'll talk more about that later with Gideon.
Like, it's relevant to the interview. So.
Yeah, I don't want to get ahead of myself.
Somehow, yeah.
Look forward to in the interview. Those of you who may have guessed what Rivix's deal is might have more to say on that when we get there. Arn, I know that's a fairly popular requested one. You know, so again, probably there's not really in this particular update, but I think we'd be open to it. So it's something that the writing team has heard all the desire for. So look forward to that. And Aaron Lanier, Aaron is married and has a kid. So, you know, whoa, back off there, guys, you know, guys and gals, like respect their relationship.
My favorite response is someone put dark, .. Interesting, .. If that doesn't summarize it, I don't know what does.
All right, cool. Moving on.
Priority is to get a Kai Zaiken romance in there as soon as possible. True.
I didn't even say it. Wasn't even me this time.
Oh my gosh. Okay, third question for now. Where's Malgus?
So we kind of hinted at it, and then I think we probably talked a lot about it in the interview, but Malgus is the whole reason you're going to be going to the Dantooine Enclave, and in pursuit of him, he's been spotted there. So you're just kind of following the trail, trying to figure out what it is that he's up to now that he doesn't seem to be following either Empress Asena or Emperor Vauron, depending on your choice, their orders anymore. So look for more info there when you actually get into the Flashpoint.
And if you want to know some of what Charles is alluding to, look to our announcement from Tuesday, put out a little teaser of stuff. So, and by I really mean teaser. It's like 8 seconds long. So,
cool. All right. So those are the questions for right now. Congratulations to the five winners that were chosen. Keep a lookout on your whispers and your messages from the SWTOR Twitch username.
Okay. Cool. Thank you, Jackie.
Yeah.
Chris Schmidt.
Oh boy. Are y'all ready? So in 6.3, we're launching a whole new system called Galactic Seasons. And as it says here on the screen, so you know the words are real, earn new and exciting rewards by completing daily and weekly priority objectives. So let's get into this. This is actually an expansion of our login reward system. There's a little bit of interplay between the two, introduced in 6.2. You will earn rewards just by playing these objectives. Lots and lots of new exciting rewards. We'll get into that in just a minute. And for subscribers, a whole lot of rewards just for y'all. And this is really designed to be a multi-month thing. So right now what we're targeting is about 5 months is a galactic season. The amount of stuff that you could potentially earn over that time is quite large, I would say. So let's get into it. We have a screenshot here of a definite work in progress. All of the rewards you see on this screen are fake, yep. But they will not be fake when it is on the PTS.
Right. As you will see in the upcoming slides, the rewards are not just complimentary experience boosts. Just hold tight.
Yes. So let me wrap this into a gift for y'all to make it easy to understand. So these are going to be themed around brand new companions. The first galactic season will be called not Season of Galactic Glamour, but it is the Stranger from Kubindi. And the companion that you will be getting at level one for both free and subscribers is Altor Zak Adon, who is a Kubaz. Something that's really cool is a lot of these prizes, you'll get a little flavors of lore and story in, you know, things like maybe some codex entries, some tool tips, things like that, that really are all themed around this companion. So what happens is, as you're doing these special objectives, and where these objectives will show up is in your conquest window, and they'll be all the way at the top, and they'll be a separate call out, a separate kind of conquest objective. But really they're not conquest objectives. They are daily and weekly objectives that are very similar to the types of objectives you'll see now in conquest, but there's only gonna be one or two for you to choose from each day. As you do them, that is how you earn these galactic season points. They're worth a set amount. There's a set amount of points for each level. So it's very predictable cadence and how quick you'll progress through. If you hit your subscriber bonus in login rewards and log in 4 times in a week, that will give you some points. But the important thing to call out here is there's a reward track for non-subscribers, and then there's a track only for subscribers. A couple other things here that to call out. You can, I won't get into too many details because it'll be on the blog that we'll post, but you can skip ahead by spending cartel coins. However, you must do so sequentially. We also have a catch-up system, so you don't feel pressure to play every single day. We have a way for you to catch up using either credits or cartel coins. But that will not be, you know, since we're saving time for money, the credit costs won't be low, but it'll be available for you to give you some more flexibility. So,
one thing quick, if I can interject real quick, absolutely. Chris, I saw nod to Swilterista, who's like, I hope there's a dev blog so I don't have to type all this. The blog might literally already be live, but it's going to happen. There you go. Dan just told me it is live. So it is very long because we have want to explain everything, but you don't yes. have to type all of it. Blog explaining all this is up if you want to read it.
But let me give you a picture of some of the rewards. If you were a subscriber, and you made it all the way through these all 100 levels of the Galactic Season, you would end up with a companion at full influence, because this companion will have specialty gifts that only apply to him. You will have an outfit for your companion. You will have weapons for your companion. You will have an outfit for you. Even in the free track, there is an outfit to earn. There's also lots of cartel coins you can earn as a subscriber. Lots and lots of new mounts, new rewards here, but we're also bringing back some old favorites that we had talked about bringing back in some way, shape, or form. So you'll also earn a very limited number of Galactic Season tokens that you can use on a vendor. And what is on that vendor? Well, it rotates between some old favorite rewards that came and went, and a couple of really awesome new rewards, which I'm going to say three words, Fleet Stronghold Apartments. So let's go to the next slide and take a look at some of the rewards. This is our new companion, Altor Zak Adon. This is the Kubaz that you can earn. And on the next slide, you'll see some of the new rewards through this system. We've got a creature mount, we've got some weapons, we've got a vehicle mount, really cool stuff. And then finally, what are these? I don't even remember these. It's been so long. Look at that Mekeb gazebo, maybe a little HK jetpack. I don't know. Getting a little crazy. So the vendor will rotate some items here and there, but some items such as the new strongholds will be on the vendor for a very, very long time. So you won't have to, they will rotate. They're not going to rotate out and retire, but it'll appear to be new stuff there from time to time. And so a couple of shots we have left are, the first is the Republic Fleet Stronghold Apartment. And as you can see, it's got a nice little view into that VIP area.
This is one room from the apartment.
This is just one room from the apartment. and then this is the Imperial, and you have a nice, another nice little shot from inside the VIP area. There's a couple little surprises here. You can check it out on the PTS, but there's a few more rooms, and a couple of them have a really beautiful space view outside. So I'll spoil it, but can't wait for you guys to see it.
So let me summarize very quickly. And I recommend reading the blog because there's a lot of details in there about like full lists of rewards and all that stuff. Play the game to complete objectives, to earn points, to earn very big, sweet rewards. It's a shame we can't always say all the things all the time, because we heard when Daily Login came out, certainly there was like, but I'm only getting this thing, because there was this other bigger system that was wrapper over top of it that gives you the big stuff. So big stuff coming. Cool. But we're not done yet.
Man, the legend.
Yeah. I should say we're mostly done with game announcements. To be fair, 6.3, we've talked mostly about 6.3. We're in the wrap down on that. But still, as we mentioned before, Darth Rivix is one of the characters relevant in 6.3. And so we took a chance to sit down and talk with Gideon Emery. This one's fun. They're all fun, but this one was also fun. We moved this one to the end because we're going to be enjoying watching chat during this one. Same reminder as before. This was pre-recorded, so please shout your love and praise of Gideon in chat, but make sure to do it on social so he can see it as well. Similar to what we did last time, any of the questions that came up around Galactic Seasons, Jackie will grab and we can answer any of those when we get back for the second giveaway. Cool. All right, Dan, kick us off. Let's talk to Gideon. All right, everyone. And we are joined today by none other than Gideon Emery. Welcome, Gideon.
Thanks for having me.
Yeah,
very excited.
We are very excited to have you on the show. This is the first time. So we do a lot of like, typically when we bring voice actors into the fold, we usually do them at, we have these physical events called cantinas, very apt based on us being a Star Wars game. We'll always bring people out and have voice actors come and join us on stage and kind of, you know, be able to mingle with people. And so in this this COVID world, doing it through live streams has kind of been our replacement. So I'm glad that we can still get our talented folks in front of the players.
Yeah, absolutely. It's a treat to be here. I just thought of a little prop, but I'll have to come back to that. Related to the general Star Wars universe.
Okay, yeah, all right, yeah. Fair enough. So for those who don't know who you are, why don't you tell everyone a little bit about yourself, where players might know you from, that kind of thing.
I'm Gideon Emery. I've been voice acting since 93, but in terms of games, only since about 03. Folks probably recognize my voice from Balthier in Final Fantasy XII, Fenris Dragon Age 2, and certainly I've had some fun in the Star Wars universe, Clone Wars, the Star Wars, Lot Dodd, Mi Dici, you know, some fun characters there, and now here we are with Old Republic. So it's also nice as well when people allow me to channel me, obviously dialed in certain directions of good and questionable, but it's nice to sort of lean more into my own accent a bit. Yeah,
there you go. I thought you were saying more lean into your evil. I thought you were going to more into like my evil
lean
side.
Lean into my evil.
It's really
side.
Thought where I thought you were going there.
Yeah,
you're definitely kind of known for a lot of accents. Actually, like you've played so many different. Like, what's probably the furthest weirdest one you think you've probably done? Like I can think of like, I remember you as like, you've been Russian, you've been Irish, you've been, you know, it's so many different things.
Yeah, and Scottish and stuff. I mean, I really enjoy Scottish for some reason, because it sort of lets you sort of break loose, kind of sort of out of the mold. I don't know why, or maybe the characters I've done in that realm. I do really enjoy doing stuff that's close to me, because I feel sort of on camera, you know, it's more, yeah, there's a lot of the Russian and, you know, at least 50% American, which obviously I have fun doing. I will confess that my wife had an audition yesterday for a Midwest / Minnesota is what they were looking for, and I was of no help, because it's like, yeah, that's not in my bag. We're gonna have to call her. We're gonna have to phone a friend. Yeah.
Cool. Well, Charles, you want to talk a little bit about what Gideon is bringing to SWTOR?
Yeah. So of course you're playing Darth Rivix, whom players have met and chatted with a few times, but you know, they'll be actually going on a mission with him here in the very near future. So that'll be kind of their first time getting into the action with him. So you know, for me, certainly from writing Rivix, one of the really fun things about him is that he's, you know, he's a bit different from most Sith, right? He's not the Darth Vader type. So, you know, for you, like, how do you approach kind of playing him and kind of, you know, tell us a little bit about it.
I think, look, I've definitely played several villains in my time. And I think what makes villains interesting in a general sense is they can have a little more fun. You know, they're not the hero, so they're perhaps, you know, bound by certain constraints of behavior, ethics, these kinds of things. So they're a little more juicy for an actor, perhaps. And certainly with regards to Rivix, what's nice about him is, you know, there's that very cultured, articulate, and understated. And for me doing that, I relish that kind of stuff, because it's not the, you know, getting your hands dirty, you know, sort of, you know, you send other people off to do that kind of thing, you know, and here and there you'll intervene. And certainly I had fun doing something similar in this character on Teen Wolf I played and Deucalion. So I think then I like the sort of the attention to detail, you know, that those characters seem to come with, you know, whether it's, you know, the dress, or you know, mannerisms and that kind of stuff. And it's also nice for me to just dial it back, for me personally, Gideon, because I can run through the day running a little bit like this, and this is where it is and stuff. And also I'm a dad, and so that's like, that just elevates my thing, and I've got to remind myself to. And so when I get to play a role like Darth Rivix, where it's a little more rooted, a little, you know, not that I'm perhaps quite as scheming or possibly manipulative as Darth may be. I mean, who knows?
Yeah. Yeah.
I like that you say, by the way, that you can use playing a Darth as a way to level yourself up.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, look, people may find that, as I say that, I realize the inherent confession, but there is something there where there it is. It is a little more centered energetically than myself. Although I do pride myself on my own personal integrity, though, which may not be in alignment with Sith, but you know.
Well, that's part of the fun of this is you know, because the project's been going so long and we've done so many, we actually, you know, we get to really explore lots of different types of people, right? Not all Sith need to be Darth Vader or Emperor Palpatine. We can have the, you know, a Sith with a code of honor or a particular code of ethics, or someone like Rivix, who's, you know, like you said, very kind of organized, very chill, seems very in command of things, never seems to be that angry, never seems to be plotting against you, but you never know. Yeah.
Yeah.
On that note, you know, that is definitely something Sith are known for, right? Is they betray each other, they stab each other in the back. It's kind of their whole deal. What do you? Not to spoil anything, of course, but you know, what do you think? Do you think Rivix is someone, you know, because he certainly makes an effort to be trustworthy. Do you think that's something
As do I. I was just to go back to what you mentioned. It's like I do make an effort to be nice and whatnot, and I seem very nice to people who meet me in person. But the roles I play tend to have an undercurrent of, well, would we really let him babysit? Perhaps not. I mean, maybe if we were in the same room together, you know, but if I went out, yeah, maybe not. I think we'll see. You know, it's interesting, because the important thing for me as an actor is never to judge the character I'm playing. And I don't think that under the broad term of villains, if you want to classify, you know, any character as a villain, and I use that loosely, I don't think they think of themselves as you know, inherently bad or good necessarily. Some of them think of themselves, of course, as God's gift, but with the ego removed, and I don't think, you know, Rivix is all ego, although he's definitely has, you know, self-confidence and charm, and that obviously comes from ego, but I don't think he considers himself as someone who couldn't be trusted, and as he says, you know, perhaps not a drink now, but I would definitely enjoy one with you later, you know, and that you can interpret that as you will, you know, and how the evening goes, well, that's up to you.
Yeah, he's someone who always kind of leaves you just wanting a little bit more, maybe waiting for that little bit more. It kind of keeps you on the hook.
Is there, because you mentioned too that, you know, Rivix kind of sticks out a little bit as a villain. Is there anything that that comes differently here as either playing Rivix compared to other villains, or how you would approach Rivix versus heroes that you may have played in the past?
I think Rivix is more cerebral. You know, you could perhaps say calculating in a sense. I think you're a lot of heroes tend to be like, this is what I've got to do, and they plunge into the good fight, you know, come hell or high water. And I think characters who are a little more cerebral and perhaps on the fence in terms of qualitatively good or bad, you know, they take their time and there's a little more preparedness. So it doesn't mean they don't act from here, but for the most part, I think they do take a little more time. I don't know, perhaps that's like one characteristic I can draw, as opposed to, you know, sort of donning the cape instantly and you know, blasting off to go, you know, save the situation.
Would it be different if Rivix had a cape?
He does have a nice coat.
There's a nice coat for sure. I've never worn a cape on or off screen. So I also think they could be cumbersome and you know, so practicality is everything.
True. That's true. So as a game, SWTOR has been running for, this will be our 10th year. We'll hit at the end of this year, a 10 year anniversary. And so we obviously have a long, you know, storied history. What's it like coming into kind of a, you know, a long running established game and storyline to bring, you know, this new central character into the story?
I've been asked similar things before, and I gotta give you a similar answer, and it's, if I allow the weight of the, you know, the brand or the title, you know, to impact what I do, I'm gonna have to excuse myself and run. So my best advice to myself, at least, is to kind of take it with a pinch of salt. Just try and bring my best self, and lean obviously heavily on, you know, creators and writers to at least share and guide me in the right direction, so I'm not leaping off the edge, because I can't possibly know the magnitude and the legacy and the biography of, you know, everyone I'm going to be interacting with. You know, that I just don't have enough man years between now and the record, sort of thing. Yeah, I have, you know, I'll come in with all deference and don my cap and then do my best to just bring my most sort of authentic self, you know, to the role.
Yeah, that's a good answer. Yeah, one thing. So, and this is maybe a Charles / Gideon question. Is there anything that sticks out to both of you from doing the sessions? You know, when you were recording Rivix, is there anything that sticks out about something with the character that was driven by something that Charles had written or anything that comes to mind?
I think for me, at least the way I introduced the character to him was that, you know, he's, which is a little extreme. It's not exactly where we went, but, you know, sort of a sexy David Bowie vampire was more or less.
Right. That's right.
Yeah. You know, like, he needs to be someone who's very charming, but definitely there's like an undercurrent where you're like, is he going to kill me? And I think that, you know, luckily you didn't, you know, we didn't go into the realm of impression because you are very good at your job, but, you know, I feel like whatever weird example, you know, expression of what I was after that is, I feel like you just nailed it. You hit the ground running and you were right in it.
That's good to know. You've reminded, because honestly, I'd forgotten that, and that was the leaping off point. And I think I probably took a beat. No, there's definitely something to hook into, but it's also a tall order. I think there's definitely characters like Darth Rivix where I would like aspire to be, or you know, like your sexy Bowie vampire amalgam, where I would love to think that I could be that. I can clearly only play that in an audio realm, because in person it's simply not going to happen. You know, I have no game,
I'm sure. So of course we're pre-recording this, so we won't be able to see the chat, but when it does air,
I'm so excited.
There'll be a lot of people disagree about this.
I'm so excited that I asked that question and that Charles said the words sexy David Bowie vampire out loud. That's gonna stick around for a while.
I'll be getting tweets about that for the rest of my life. That'll be
that's pretty good. I mean, hey, if there's a brand to wear, sexy David Bowie vampire is a brand I would happily aspire to.
Yeah, I think we all should.
Yeah,
SDBV, and then we can just people are like, hashtag. What's SDBV? It's like, if you have to ask, you know, right. Yeah.
It's a new Gen Z thing you wouldn't understand.
Yeah.
Wow, that's good. Charles, anything else for Gideon before we head into to wrapping up? Because I really don't know that we're going to close any stronger than Sexy Gideon.
No, just so excited to have you join us today, and really, Rivix is just getting started, so. Maybe in the future we'll get to loop back after he does some spectacularly crazy thing that I'm definitely not hinting toward, and check back in with you and give our players a taste down the road, because like I said, he's just getting started. It's a lot of fun.
Is there anything you want to add, Gideon, today?
I'd love to come back and hopefully give some more perspective where we can talk about things and what may or not happen, and also by then hopefully my cut it with my dog's clippers hair will have shaped itself into something a little more presentable.
It looks great. Would have never known that it wasn't just a professional haircut.
My wife had to do cleanup. I started on the sides and I realized that it wasn't as long as, I just got to follow through.
There you go.
Yeah.
I understand. That's how I landed at this haircut that I've had for like 20 years. Cause I was like attachment cut forever.
Hey, it's great. Yeah.
Wherever it lands. Cool. Well, Gideon, thank you so much for joining us today. This has been super fun, and hopefully, like Charles said, we have to bring you back once players get a little better taste of Rivix. Then we can provide some more. You can provide some more context once they know some more things.
And I will say thanks. Yeah, thanks so much to you guys, and thanks to the fans. Keep on playing, and hopefully we'll find each other out there. And just a confession that. My hollow does me no justice.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
All right. Take care, guys.
Take care. Thank you.
Welcome back, everybody. That was fun. We enjoyed. Charles and I had so much fun with that. That one, I would say it got away from us, but man, that one was fun. Gideon was
we are 100% professional in all aspects of this.
Correct.
I don't know what you're talking
about. At all times. That's right. So if Gideon's watching or even after, again, please give him all the shouts on social. He was super fun, obviously a very good sport, and had some good stories to tell along with Charles. So fun as always, please give him shouts on the social. And we're moving towards the end, but that means more free stuff.
Yes, Jackie. Giveaways. All right, we're picking five more winners who will be receiving the Vectron Minot Jetpack. So two things that's really cool about this particular item is players can toggle to adjust the direction of the flames, and the flame color is dependent upon the color crystal that you have equipped. So all you have to do to enter the giveaway is chat already picked up on it. Just type something in chat, and you will be entered to win one of these jetpacks. We'll be choosing five winners. When those winners are chosen, chat will actually freeze. So it stops for you. That's intentional. Don't worry. The stream didn't die, et cetera, et cetera. When winners are chosen, we will be sending you a message via Whisper on the Twitch platform to give you your item. So keep an eye out for that. And I think that's it for the giveaway. While that's happening, I have some questions for team. So let's go ahead and get into this. For Galactic Seasons, are the rewards character or legacy based?
They are legacy based, and they will unlock in collections. Hooray! And just to follow up on that also, the points that you're earning are also all legacy based. So you're not expected to do this per character. Your efforts will apply across your whole legacy and will be in collections.
Awesome. Okay. Coming up, next question. Nico, Okar, Paxton roll when? ...
Interesting. I would say that the vendor will have some interesting things on rotation. So be sure to check out the vendor and maybe we'll surprise you.
Going on to the next question. When it comes to seasons, will I have to be subscribed for the full 5 months to get the sub rewards, or will I be able to sub at the end and claim them all?
That's a great question. And so to clarify, first of all, there is no buy-in price for Galactic Seasons. It's free. But as a subscriber, you're getting access to the subscriber track. So what happens is your progress will continue whether you are subscribed or not. If you're not subscribed, it will continue at a slower rate. However, you would not be earning those subscriber rewards. But let's say you played for free for 3 months and then decided to subscribe. You would earn the subscriber rewards for what you have earned along the free track. So you wouldn't get every reward. You would only get the rewards that you would have earned.
So if you're at level 30 as a free-to-play player and then you press subscribe, you would unlock then immediately get the subscriber rewards from 1 to 30.
That is correct. Yep.
Awesome. That's pretty much it for Galactic Seasons. I have one kind of like general question, if y'all don't mind sure. Answering that. Double XP, when? I love the format of all these questions. I'm just reading them verbatim.
Statement, comma, when?
soon with the trademark. No, probably shortly after 6.3, I would anticipate. Does that sound right?
Yeah, not before 6.3, but after 6.3. It's on our radar. We just were talking about this like two days ago.
Yeah,
the details. Yep.
Cool. Yep.
Thanks, Jackie.
Yeah, of course.
Let's close this thing out. The words I wrote on the slide. here's what's coming in 6.3. New flashpoint, secret to the Enclave. As we have shared, we'll put the screenshots up on social and stuff if you want to take a look. It's continuing the events of what happened in 6.2. For those of you who haven't played it and yelled spoilers at us, now's the time. Get caught up. It's good. Galactic Seasons, Chris talked through quite a bit of it. Just a reminder, there is a massive blog right now on sportswear.com. You can go take a look, get all the details, get a good understanding of the rewards, how you earn them, et cetera, et cetera. It's going to reiterate a lot of the things we already said, but if you'd rather get it in written form, there you go. You can play 6.3 on PTS soon with extra TMs. I'll say out loud, we are targeting next week. Tentative, subject to change because it's a test build, but targeting next week. Also, secondary note, when we did 6.2 on PTS, it was not available on Steam. PS were available on Steam now. And so it's going to be this time. So actually tomorrow morning, we're going to push PTS up on Steam. We're going to, assuming everything goes well. That means if you're a Steam user and you want to go start downloading PTS on Steam, you can. It's not going to be 6.3, it's going to be 6.2.1, but it'll at least get you most of the way downloaded. So you have to download less when we get there. So it's available on Steam now as well. And then you guys won't be able to hear him, but I can relate. Dan, when are we putting up the Moira and Gideon interviews? Moira will be up tomorrow on YouTube, and then Gideon will be up on Saturday. We'll be sure to put him on social and stuff so you can check them out if you want to watch them. I'm seeing a lot of questions about a 6.3 release date. So standard structure for us, we're going to put it on PTS first. So we can get your hands on the Flashpoint, your hands on Galactic Seasons, give us feedback. And then depending on how that goes, we're already planning a few weeks of PTS with some rolling changes as we go throughout. So we'll give you the release date when we get some time with 6.3 on PTS, but you got a little bit. It's going to bake on PTS for a little while. That's it. That's everything on the list. I've run out of words on the slide. Is there anything I'm missing? Any other pending crazy question stuff? I'm seeing a lot of people spamming 10-year hint. We have not forgotten it's our 10-year anniversary. Don't worry.
I mean, it's not our, it's not officially our 10th anniversary until December. So
correct. That's true. That's true.
We're swimming in nine and change land, I think.
That's true. Nine and change land. That was my band name in high school, by the way. We were a sixpence none the richer cover band. I don't know where I'm going with this joke.
That's where my head went immediately.
Anyway. The stream's about 6.3. Don't worry, there'll be more. There's more, more stuff this year. We got a long, exciting year ahead of us, so fear not. All right, it has been a pleasure as always. I want to thank Jackie, Chris, Charles for joining us as always on stream. Dan Steed, who's telling me words in my them doing one of these. Dan's telling me words in the back. Immense props to Dan Steed, who works in the background, and you can't see him putting this all together. Please round of applause and chat for Dan as he quivers in fear in the background. Stick around. We're going to host one of our content creators. We're going to host Marcus from Working Class Nerds, right? Did I get that right, Dan? Yes. Great. So stick around for some extra SWTOR words about, I'm assuming, about all of our announcements. I don't know what Marcus is going to talk about. That's it. That's been 6.3. So we look forward to seeing you on PTS. Please next week, hopefully next week when we put it up, jump on, give us your feedback. Even today, read the season's blog. Let us know what you think. We're pretty excited about all the rewards and stuff that are coming your way. We know there's been questions about apartment strongholds for a long time. So now you got two coming your way. Awesome.
Great.
Thank you very much, everybody.
Thank you all so much. Great to see everybody.
Bye.